All right, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Bold TV. I'm John Levine, an incoming media editor at The Wrap, and I'm here with my co-host, John Burnett. He is an author, professor, and co-founder of One Empire Group. Good morning, John.
Good morning, John.
Good to see you.
Likewise.
So thank you all for watching on our on Facebook, and don't forget to like our page and also follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat. And if you love Bold TV, share the show with your friends.
We want to hear from you all, so make sure you add your questions and comments during the show.
So before we talk about what's in the news this week, we'd like to welcome our first guest onto the show. Thanks for being here, Thomas Landstreet, the founder of N3L Capital Partners, who has said I can call him Tom.
That's correct, you can.
Okay, fantastic. So Tom, can you tell us, first question out of the gate, can you tell us what the Trump administration is proposing with tax reform as we know right now?
Well, he's obviously trying to reduce rates. He's trying to simplify the code. There's seven different brackets now. He's trying to reduce it to three. He's lowering the top rate only to 35%, which is the only problem I have with it. Of course, it's a political hot potato when, you know, you're trying to give away to the rich, so-called rich, who, by the way, have only gotten richer under the Obama regime. If you notice the disparity between rich and poor, it's gotten much, much worse, and it often does under Democrats. So the argument falls flat. He's also trying to concentrate the tax cuts on the corporate sector, which, of course, is necessary to compete with European and other countries where they have an average tax rate of 24%. Ours is 35. Wow. So that's a very difficult situation for any company. And I'm a small business owner. I really appreciate that, honestly. I'll quit paying. Right now, I use my corporation to pass through the taxes to my personal level. I'll pay it there. I'll change that. And I will change my incorporation to take advantage of these tax cuts. And guess what? I'll probably hire somebody. I've been dying to hire this kid. I'm paying him part-time. I want him so bad, and I can't afford him. I will. The first thing I do will probably hire this young man that I've got as an analyst at my firm.
Well, being that you just mentioned young, well, I should say the youth, what's in it for millennials?
Millennials are a fantastic generation because they are so independent. They're also creative. They're also smart, and they're entrepreneurs. In fact, the number of businesses being founded by millennials is far above my peers during my generation. And I've got three of them as kids, by the way. And they really are independent thinkers. I would love to capture their imagination and let them know that their creativity and energy should be unfettered. It should be unencumbered. And all government does is disrupt. Right. It regulates, it restricts. And by the way, when you tax something, do you know you get less of it?
It's true.
If it's labor, you get less of it. If it's capital, you get less of it.
But what can you tell millennials, right? Really break it down, simplify it. How does it put money into their pockets?
Yeah. Well, simply, they don't have to pay the government, which is a net revenue loser.
Right.
You know, if you look at GDP, you know that government spending is about 40% of GDP. I would argue government spending actually detracts from the economy. Any time that you are incentivizing an individual to keep more of what they earn and to make more, you're actually making their life a lot richer on earth.
I'd like to kind of point in for a minute. Is it not true that if we gave these sort of very large tax breaks away, that we would increase the deficit considerably? And didn't that happen under the Bush tax cuts in 2001?
Well, if it does happen, it's only because the guys in Washington, the women in Washington, are unwilling to cut spending. We have a very large deficit.
Right.
You could probably cut our government by one-third and nobody would even notice.
What would you cut by one-third that people wouldn't notice?
Well, entitlements, first off.
People wouldn't notice entitlements?
Mm,
I don't know. I think a lot of people would notice.
Not if they had a job.
Mm.
I don't think people thrive when they're getting things for free from welfare. I don't think that's the proper role of a human being given one life on earth.
Well, you were fortunate to work with the economist Art Laffer, right? And he was noted for saying, we can't tax our way to prosperity and we can't spend our way out of debt.
Right.
That's exactly true. The wanton spending in Washington is unbelievable. And I've got the statistics as an example. After the housing crisis, the 08 crisis, people in Washington, as Art Laffer also said, behave like little girls in a scary movie. Hank, they passed trillions and trillions of dollars of spending, one of which an $800 billion shovel-ready, remember the shovel-ready spending project, infrastructure? There's no visible evidence of that infrastructure spending everywhere, anywhere. Potholes are everywhere.
But is it fair to say you would be against the current tax cuts from the Trump administration as if they don't have corresponding spending cuts or they're not paid for in some way? Is that a correct assessment of your beliefs?
If it meant that we did not get tax cuts, I would not agree with that. I would rather see tax cuts than anything.
Do you believe they pay for themselves?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, I'm sorry.
I just don't think there's a lot of evidence.
Your questioning, John, I think is definitely on point. However, I'm reminded of what President JFK stated: for every dollar that's spared from taxation, creates a new job and a new salary.
Well, tax rates were a lot higher when JFK was president than they are now. I think there's a diminishing rate of return to that kind of logic.
Right. But when they
know that when George W. Bush did his tax cuts in 2001, you know, the deficit exploded and we had a decade of anemic growth. And all of the growth went to 85%, I believe, went to the top 1%.
But George Bush was a very big spender.
He was a big spender.
I mean, you're right.
So, but they didn't pay for themselves.
Dollar for dollar, it may not, but you've got to cut spending. You do have to cut entitlements.
Double the deficit. And I'm the millennial sort of on this show right now. And I take, honestly, great offense to blowing up the deficit by, you know, these people in Washington are going to make these decisions that are going to make my life harder long after they're gone. And it's very, very unnerving to me to see all these tax cuts that are going to be instituted. They're not going to get paid for.
They need to be paid for by spending cuts. You're right. The government is simply too large. It's involved in too much. An example is, if you look at the states, of course, states have a requirement that they actually balance their budget. But did you know that the states with the highest marginal tax rates also have the highest budget deficits?
True.
One for one. If you look at Connecticut, you look at Illinois, they have the highest tax rates and the highest budget deficits. So there's no correlation between high tax rates and a better budget. There is none.
Right.
None.
But California is obviously known on your side for having very high taxes, but their economy is thriving. And meanwhile, Kansas radically lowered taxes over the last decade, and obviously they are not thriving. They've had a number of economic difficulties, as I'm sure you know. So I'm curious. I don't necessarily believe the idea that it would pay for itself. And I want to talk to sort of other things in the tax code.
You bring up something very important about California.
Of course, yeah.
In 2000, when the internet bubble was forming and there were so many IPOs and so many stock options and there was so much wealth being created in California, they had a projected budget deficit, actually surplus. Then when the internet bubble burst and you saw all those tax revenues disappear, they were facing a $13 billion budget deficit within 2 years. The reason is because 25% of the state's general budget revenues came from two different taxes, exercise stock options and realized capital gains. So that's a progressive tax rate where you're skewing your tax revenues at the richest individuals in the country. And then when you have a boom, then a bust, those revenues disappear and suddenly the state was in huge, you know, financial mess. So just a point.
I want to draw your attention to New York Times analysis just published, I believe today, saying that, and we can actually put it on the screen, if you will, that Donald Trump would personally stand to save $1 billion on his tax returns, as far as we know about his tax returns, if tax reform is passed in its current form. Is that something you think is good?
Hell yes.
You don't think that someone like Donald Trump should
I don't care. I'm not a big fan of Donald Trump, honestly.
Right.
It doesn't matter.
People like him, you know.
Oh, of course they
save billions of
dollars. Doesn't bother me one bit. I want more rich people. I want you to be rich.
Does it make more rich people saving Donald Trump that money?
Pardon?
Would saving Donald Trump that $1 billion create more rich people?
Perhaps. He may hire another 50 people.
Right.
I don't care about whether he makes money off these tax cuts or not. The truth is what you and I and the rest of us get, and I think it's substantial.
Would it not be better, instead of him saving one person saving $1 billion, if, you know, how many dozens of Americans could save money? And, you know, if that tax cut went to the bottom quartile and they could spend that money in the economy.
That's not how
it
works.
I think Donald Trump is probably going to put that money and save it or invest it.
That's not how it works. The people,
I think that's a lot of how it works.
No, people who earn a daily wage and that's all they get with a W-2 do not have the ability to invest. It's not as dynamic. That's the whole point behind the Laffer curve. Rich people have more tools in their toolbox to put this money that they save
trickle
to
down.
Work.
You're talking about trickle down. I think that what the evidence of trickle down shows is he's not just going to go out and spend every single dollar he gets back from the government. He's going to invest it. He's going to save it. He's going to do smart, you know, rich person things.
I certainly would.
And that's great if you own a lot of Google stock or your JP Morgan Chase. It's not, you know, if you want people to go out and spend their tax refunds, you should give it to the bottom quartile. They're the ones who spend it. Every study says
that. Well, they did that. So during the big spending binge after the 08 housing crisis, along with the shovel-ready infrastructure projects, they sent out $800 million in the form form of checks to Joe Sixpack and Joe Sixpack and his wife. $600 to Joe, $1,200 if you're married. If you paid too much in taxes, you didn't get it. $800 billion of mailbox money was sent to the average American. What? With an assumption that each dollar would end up being $2.3 as it trickled down through the economy. Guess what? It didn't.
Look, you know, you can't prove a negative, but it's widely assumed by economists that the economic recession, we avoided a depression because of very aggressive monetary policy, like from the Federal Reserve and the stimulus, and they're making the cutoff sign, so we got to go. But I could probably argue with you all day about this. But anyway, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
The pleasure was ours. Thomas Landstreet. All right.